I'm here to declare to you.
Quickly, if you would just turn your Bibles to Romans, and in Romans, the 12th chapter, and from that 12th chapter, I'm going to ask you to stand, because I said I'm here to read from the Word of God. And you know, we revere the Word of God. We don't keep a seat when Scripture is being read. We stand on in glory for the Word. If it were not for the Word, where would we be? Because for the Word, you'd still be on the side of the road. If it wasn't for the Word, you wouldn't have had a roof over your head last night. If it were not for the Word, sickness might have taken over your body. Amen, amen. Romans 12, and from that 12th chapter, just two verses, and it reads, "Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters," look at somebody and say, "That's me and you." In view of God's mercy, look at somebody and say, "I'm glad about His mercy."
I'm glad about His mercy.
Urge you in view of His mercy to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. I mean, I'm expecting you to do great things with your life, holy and pleasing unto God. Look at somebody and say, "We are His vessel."
We are His vessel.
And then it says, "This is your true and proper worship." In other words, God said, "This is the way I want you to get it done." Verse 2, "Do not conform to the pattern of this world.
Yes, yes.
Be transformed by the renewing of your mind." Look at somebody and say, "Some things you just got to do for yourself." After this, the end of words says, "Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will." I thank God, and so I ask that you would pray with me and pray for me right now as I title this sermon, "That Makes Me Wanna Holler." Makes me wanna holler. Yes, taken from the late great Marvin Gaye. He wrote a song that depicted all of the transformation and confusion that was going on, not only in the world, but specifically in the African-American community. And when I look around today, as I thought about this morning, and all it is that Dr. King did, and all it is that he went through, and all it is that he suffered through, yet to see some of the things that are going on today, it just makes me want to holler. When I think about how it is that Rosa Parks had enough courage to speak up and say, "I'm not going to the back of the bus," but so many will fight over the last seat or fight over things that are so petty when so many things are so important that are facing us today, it just makes me want to holler. When I look at all of the injustice and all of the pettiness and all of the things that we fight about, when there are bloodsheds, when I look at the streets of this city that are named after presidents and named after states, and almost every street has had some form of blood because they've been renamed by gangs and renamed by stupidity and renamed by things that don't matter, and bloodshed has somewhat become the norm of the day, I tell you, beyond four walls, it just makes me want to holler. When I think about school, I think about school. So many don't even have a clue as to what it took to get you into the schools that you are in today. I think about my mother here, sitting here, because I was bused. The first busing class in the city of Gary, Indiana, I was a part of in 1967, 1968. The schools were integrated in the city of Gary. The kids on the west side of town were bused out to Glen Park. We were put in Cooney and Milton and Lew Wallace. See, some of y'all, and Bailey, some of y'all just missed that. Because what you missed is that if they had to be integrated, that means there were no African Americans living in the community that the schools were surrounded by. And when I think about how we have kids that are doing dumb things today, kids kids that are skipping school, kids that are giving up their life for falsehood, kids that are wearing colors and wearing your pants below your belt instead of trying to improve your IQ and your education. When I look around at all of this stuff, it just makes me wanna holler. I think about my mom when they told her that they were going to bus me out to Cooney School. My mother went down and sat and waited for 3 hours at the superintendent's office until she got her a meeting. He had put her off a day, and she said, if you're going to bus my child, I don't have a problem with that, because I believe that we should be integrated in schools. But if you're going to take one of my children, you're not going to do them like they did back in the day and split up my family. You're going to have to bus both my children out to the school system. And when I think about how it is that we act like we deserve the right to be in Maryville and Sherrifville, somebody died so you could get there. Somebody went through some things so you could have that housing. Somebody gave their all. And then so many times we take it for granted. It just makes me wanna holler. Yes, I wish I had some witnesses up here with me today. You see, we've been through too much to sit back on our hands right now. We've gone through too much to forget about where we've come from. I look around me today and I get disappointed. I can even watch a TV show and see an African American in a prime role. Every time I cut on the TV and watch a sitcom, I have to see an African American sister. Aren't there some black men that can be in a relationship with black women on TV? Aren't there some things that can't go on? And when I look at all of this stuff, it gets inside of my soul. I'm not talking prejudice. I'm just talking. There's some black business owners that are men. There's some black doctors that are men. There are a lot of college graduates that are African American men. There are a lot of brothers who have given their heart and their soul. And we deserve to be featured and to be seen on TV, and not with bandanas and not with pistols and not beating our women and not walking out on our children. When I look at how we're depicted today, it just makes me want to say, yes, I'm going through and I'm reading and I'm doing some studying, and I found a quote that was given by Dr. Robert Hill in an article written several years ago about the state of the black American church and the black American family. Dr. Hill wrote in an article dealing with many of the issues that plague the black church and the black family today. Dr. Hill wrote that after making unprecedented strides in the 60s and part of the 70s, that the African American family suffered a sharp decline in the 80s and it stretched over into the 90s. Oh, you might as well come with me. I'm going to go there anyhow. Dr. Hill went on to describe how poverty rose from 6% amongst African Americans to 20% by the early or late 1990s. And then he went on to talk about and touch on how the harsh economic blows of our country has affected or hurt people from all walks of life. But the blows to our households and the blows to the black family has continued to show up in many ways. And I understand why Marvin Gaye said it makes me want to holler. You see, we got issues that are going on in our communities today. We got black on black crime. I wish I had somebody praying with me right now. We had gang violence that seems that you can't live on a block unless you claiming something. But I stopped by to tell my young people today that the only thing you ought to be claiming is the goodness of Jesus Christ. And the only thing you ought to be raising is your hands up in praise. Because if it were not for Jesus on your side, where would you be right now? If it wasn't for your praying grandmama or your great-great-grandmama, you wouldn't have a grandma. You would have a chance to get the things done today. So if you want to claim something, you need to get up on your feet right now. Put your phone down. Take the headphones down. And where my young people at? And stand up today. It ain't a shame to let the whole world know that I love Jesus. And I'm all about Jesus. And I'm going to make it because of Jesus. And I ain't claiming nobody but the blood of Jesus. Where my parents at to salute our children? Drugs, and then we got drug trafficking. Kids being convinced that you don't have to use the dope, just carry the dope in the schools. Then we have kids that their only solution is to fight or violate one another. Oh, it's real quiet right now. While we have a record number of African American children for petty confrontations. Homelessness is at an all-time high in our society. It's all over. And our decline that should get your attention the most is the decline of the standard of living that we are living under as a race of African-American people. That network, it used to be among the black families, believe it used to be one of the greatest strengths that the African-American community and African-American family had. But because of the economic uncertainties that are existing in the world that we live on today, many of the people that we used to turn to for help, we can't go to them and get help anymore because they're hurting just as bad as we are. In many houses and cases within our community, we have reached a point where our household can no longer operate as a family household is supposed to operate. Oh, can I back that thing up right now? We have so many black men that are unemployed or underemployed. And this holds true for many teenagers because I'm tired of our kids being stereotyped. Because we got a whole lot of children that would prefer to work and prefer to get it done than turn around and live a street life. We have so many homes today that are being headed up by single parent families who themselves were young or are still young and in many instances had to quit school or have their educational dreams become deferred when in an instance of stopping them from becoming marketable because of the decisions or the things that have happened to them in their life. But where it shows up most is that for a young parent today, child care cost is through the roof. So a lot of people can't go to work because they can't afford to have somebody to keep their kids. I'm going to teach this thing this morning. I got some points to look at somebody and say, it makes me want to holler. But one of the most sobering things I want you to hear today, and parents, I need you to catch this too. We now live in a world where a high school diploma will never pay for you or take care of all your bills. You have to put some more into your mind. You have to put some more into your study. You have to put some more into your life than just getting a GED or a high school diploma. You got to set yourself up for success. You got to set yourself up for that degree. You got to set yourself up for that business. You got to set yourself up for that trade school. Well, everybody don't have to go to school and become a doctor. You can become the best mechanic. You can become the best statistician. You can become the best plumber. You can become the best carpenter. Or it's an opportunity that exists out here, but a high school diploma just won't get it. Don't you let nobody sell you today and say, all you got to do is finish high school and then you're done. When you finish high school today, it's just the beginning of the journey. You want to have a plan where you're going to put at least 5 to 7 or 8 more years into your life and educate yourself so that nobody will ever be able to tell you you're not qualified. Many have forgotten, but just don't know that it was the church that was the backbone to what it is that we have that's going on right now. Many have forgotten it was the church that opened its doors. Many don't even realize that when it comes to Harriet Tubman, that one of her key rocks in freeing slaves was the route that she took from the South into the church in Michigan City. Hundreds and hundreds of African Americans were put in the church in Michigan City and kept there for safety until she go down and come back and go down and come back. Oh, y'all not with me right now. I thank God for the fact of people like Harriet Tubman, for the pioneers that put their best foot forward and did not worry about death, but put their life on the line so a wretch like you and me could walk around the campus of IUN or Purdue. The church is the foundation of the community. And I believe that God is still looking to and counting on the church and its body of believers to show the world that it's time for you to turn your back on the things that set you back, but turn your hope to the one that will never let you down. This is why I believe that the church and church leadership is under such great attack. Every time you turn around, a church is under attack, or a pastor is under attack, or a leader is under attack. It's because our arch enemy of this world, Satan, knows that the wake-up call for God to his people is taking place right now. And church. But let me tell you something right now. Something might happen with a person, but that should never have an effect on how you serve God. Something might go down with people, but you should never let the devil make you quit having a relationship. Something might go down with people, but you should never let the devil make you quit having a relationship with God because of something that somebody else did. Oh, I wish I had some believers with me right now. Nothing should be able to discourage you. Or I'll get my praise on by myself right now because God didn't bless me because of what somebody else did. God didn't open the door for me because of what somebody else said. God did what he did for me because he loved me enough when he gave his only begotten son, our Lord and Savior Jesus. And since Jesus has not, cannot, and will not ever change, ain't nothing nobody can do to stop me from coming in my Father's house and get my praise on and get my worship on and get all. Oh, I wish I had somebody with me up in here today. God has been too good to you for a scandal to stop you from serving God. Look at somebody saying, they're just excuses.
But this wake up will not happen unless we wake up to what God is calling for. And that's why this word in Romans 12, 1 and 2 is so important. Because my God is looking for a renewed, some renewed mind. Why? Because an imprisoned church can never prosper for the Lord. Yeah. Look at somebody say, we got to take the handcuffs off. I look at three more people, say the handcuffs got to come off. So 2013 is different than 1913. It's some things going on right now, and where am I going with this? We can never have a church that focuses on just Sunday morning only. Leaving the people of God open to the plot and the plan of Satan for the other 6 days left in the week. We can no longer have a church. We must have a church that has a call of a spiritual renewing. We must have a church that goes out and reinstates its biblical values. We must have a church that is sympathetic and understands the importance of education and academic preparation for our children as well as for our adults. We must have a church that keeps its past alive. We shouldn't wait till Black History Month or Hispanic Month or whatever culture it is, come on, that you run and designate that. And that's the time we gonna give all the information. All the information should be kept in front of us at all time. We must be a church that invests in the youth of our church. No longer can we tell them, baby, I'm praying for you, or pet them on the back, or just encourage them. We must make the sacrifices and take the time and let them know that we care about them. The streets don't wait up. The society don't wait up. Gangbangers don't wait up. The man selling condoms don't wait. Both the birth control pills don't wait. But we talking about they ain't old enough yet. Or we got to give them a couple of more years. I want some folk with me up in beyond four walls that will have my back and stand with me this morning and say we ain't waiting on nothing else. That we going to invest in our children. That we going to start to them as soon as they start walking. Teaching them about
something and you from another generation, don't turn your nose up at that kid because back in the day you were doing something. What's all that rap music? What's all that dissing? What's all that? Don't forget that when you were growing up, somebody was asking you, what's all that rock and roll? What's all that Bobby Sox about? What's that hat do about? Don't judge our young people by such a negative standard. Try to understand what they are going through and try to understand what they have go through each and every day, and then God will speak to your heart and give you some understanding so we can meet them where they are. Or it just makes me want to holler. Yes, we have to attack literacy. Literacy is a big problem, and the devil is scared of a church with an education program. You see, education offered by the church is nothing like the stuff that the world offers. You see, when you go before the world, they just give you the ABCs. But when you go to the Christian
church, I'm almost done, must be in attack. Yes, we have to be in attack through against literacy, because we have too many obstacles to keep our best and our brightest in the unemployment line for things like not being able to fill out an application or not understanding the math formulas, or we ought to do something about it. It's the church, our obligation to find out who our educators are within our sanctuary and to put some programs up. You ain't got to go pay everybody to do everything. God has put some people in the church that are good with math and good with science and good with English. And if we put them in place, we can take this thing out the box called literacy. We can do it step by step, page by page, paragraph by paragraph, promise of promises made by the Lord, because God wants us to change this thing. Point to somebody and say, attack. Yeah, it's my goal here at Beyond Four Walls, and we got to move into a program of ministries for our seasonal saints. Well, I'm about to go there right now. You see, how can we ever go forward if we don't connect with those that have already been there and already done that? Well, I got a minister right now to give you a newsflash. You see, we have so many grandmothers, Reverend Rita, that are responsible for the child care of their children's children. So you know what we have to do? We got to go and educate our grandparents and our seasoned saints so they can know how it is that they can better help educate our children. One of my goals here at Beyond Four Walls that the Lord gave me was to open up a daycare center where the grandparents can come and sit down with their babies while they're learning how to read and write and do arithmetic, because by simply sitting in with the parent and grandparent and to the child and learning what the child is learning, then the grandparent can learn how he or she can better equip or better help the child to be more functional in today's society. Oh, I wish I had somebody up in here with me right now. Look at somebody and say, attack. We got to attack by having a daycare program within the church. We ought to be offering free daycare or subsidized daycare, because child care costs in many cases is what's keeping our single parents or our low-income families from having jobs. But if the church makes a commitment to quit being money hungry, if the church makes a commitment to take the tithe and the offering and bring it to the storehouse and then work that thing in the storehouse and pay for programs and pay for funding, we can be the blessing that God wants us to be. Or I'm trying to tell somebody right now, don't get mad when you hear the church asking for money, because God has got a program and God has got a plan for this church. Single or low-income families. Yeah. Child care or lack of it, along with housing, are two of the biggest O's. We're talking about flipping that O, turning obstacles into opportunity that's needed so our people can get into the mainstream of America. Yeah. Lord have mercy. We got to be on the attack of this again with the money. Look at somebody say, it's about the Benjamins, baby. Yeah, there are grants out here and there are programs out here that can fund the things that we want to do. And if you go to the church and you are gifted as a grant writer, if you go to the church and God has shown you something, then you ought to start researching on the web and looking online and saying, pastor, or tell somebody else, I found something that can help this church. I found something that can bless a single parent. I found something for somebody that's got cancer but can't afford the health care cost. I found something for somebody that will help them go from being unemployed to employed. I found something that can help somebody to get ahead in his life. And I'm going to write this grant. And I'm going to bless, ask the Lord to bless this grant when I put this grant down on paper. And I'm going to not wait till the government tells me I got it. I'm going to look to the one that said that the government shall rest job training. I'm convinced that with just a few skills that God has already placed the next business owner, the next designer, the next architect, the next artist, the next computer whiz right here in this church. Some of y'all selfish, you still sitting there. Oh, it could be you. I gave to praise God like it could be you. See, I believe God has got the gift. See, just because you're where you're at right now doesn't mean that God doesn't have a bigger plan or a bigger purpose for you. Just because you're where you're at right now doesn't mean that God is finished with you. He's been getting you ready for law school. He's been getting you ready for med school. He's been getting you ready for nursing school. He's been getting you ready to own your own business. He's been getting you ready to open up your own gas station. He's been getting you ready to open up your own store. He's been getting you ready to open up your own clothing line. He's been getting you ready to open up your own school for training kids how to dance. Oh, I wish I had some believers. By you doing your part. Yes. Lord have mercy. Touch somebody and tell them, I need you. Or reach on the other side and just point to somebody and say, I need you. You see, you got to do your part. You can't claim God and then don't do nothing for God. You sitting up here wanting a blessing, and God is sitting up in heaven looking down at you with Jesus and the anointing of the Holy Ghost at his voice. And he's saying, you want a blessing? Let me see you be a blessing. I'm trying to help somebody right now. You want to be blessed? Let me see you be a blessing. Let me see you take the gifts that you have. Let me see you take the talents that you have. Let me see you take what it is I blessed you with and be a blessing. And then once you show me, you'll be responsible for that. I got some more stuff I can add to you. Once you show me that you can be responsible for that, I got some more doors that have been closed I'll open for you. Once you show me you can be responsible for that, I got some things that I have created just for you that's sitting right there on the shelf that can't nobody put their hand on, can't nobody sit at the table with, can't nobody lay claim to, because they are all yours. Or where my young ladies at in the church today, I'm talking to the kids as well as the single parents. I need you up on your feet right now and standing before the house of God right now. I'm here to tell you that you are more than a conqueror. I'm here to tell you that you are a blessing and a gift from God. I'm here to tell you that you ain't got to settle for no deadbeat Negro making you false promises.
moving up.